Have you ever seen someone solve the Rubik's Cube before? It's a really cool party trick to show off, but I think my favorite part about it is that it isn't actually even a trick. It's very possible for you to solve yourself, so today I'm going to show you how it works. When you scramble a Rubik's Cube, you are putting it into one of the 43 quintillion possible combinations that are possible on it. In theory, you could learn how to recognize and then solve every single scramble, and you would always be able to solve it in 20 moves or less. But memorizing such an absurd amount of moves is just out of the question. I've been told that you can solve the Rubik's Cube one side at a time to make it easier. But this is a common misconception. Getting into the mechanics of the Rubik's Cube, you can see that the colors are held together in separate pieces, making it impossible to solve each color separately. Instead, we will solve the pieces. We do this by grouping each layer individually, starting with the bottom layer and then working to the top layer. We can do this by moving around the corners and the edges, but we can't move around the centers. Looking at the core of the puzzle, you'll see that the centers are connected to the core, and they can't be moved around separately. With this in mind, we can use the centers as an anchor point, and then we can solve the other pieces around the centers, because we know we cannot move the centers around. Okay, now actually solving it. We can solve the first layer pretty intuitively, because there isn't any previous work that we need to preserve. Generally, people solve the cross and then the corners individually. The second layer is also pretty intuitive, but there are a couple of principles that you need to know in order to keep the first layer intact. Finally, we have the last layer, which is the hardest layer because we need to keep both of the previous layers completed. To solve this layer, it's going to be impossible to do without temporarily deconstructing our work, so it's not a step we do intuitively. Instead, we solve it with algorithms, which are just sequences of set moves that we use to move certain pieces around. There are almost 4,000 possible combinations that the last layer can be in, which is a huge improvement from 43 quintillion, but still a bit heavy on the memorization side. We can cut this down into a manageable size by splitting the last layer up into two steps. The first step will be getting all of the same color facing upwards, and this color will usually be yellow when you're starting out. This step is called OLL, for Orient Last Layer, and there are 57 possible combinations of the yellow colors. So that's 57 algorithms to memorize to get the yellow facing upwards. From here, there are only 21 possible permutations for the cube to be in, when the first two layers are solved and all of the yellow is facing upwards. This step is referred to as PLL for Permutate Last Layer, and that's an additional 21 algorithms to know. By breaking the last layer up into two steps, we cut down the algorithms that you need to know for the last layer from 4,000 to 78. In total, the algorithms have an average of about 9 moves, so that's still a lot of moves to memorize. But if you're dedicated, you can do it. I learned these algorithms and I'm glad I did because it shows in the speed of my solving. But not many people want to learn that many algorithms just for the last layer. To cut this down even more, we can split OLL, or the 57 algorithms to make the yellow facing up, into two steps. This method is named two look OLL because you are solving OLL in two steps or two looks at the cube. First, we can get a yellow cross on the cube, and this will require memorizing three cases. Then making the rest of the yellow facing upward will only require you to memorize 7 more algorithms. This will cut down the algorithms that you need to memorize from 78 to 30, at the cost of an extra step. To cut it down even more, we can split PLL, or the 21 algorithms to solve the rest of the cube, into two steps. This method is called two look PLL for the same reason. First, we'll solve the corners, and this will require us to memorize 2 algorithms. Then we will solve the edges, which we will need to learn 4 algorithms for. That's 6 algorithms in total. Now, by breaking the entire last layer up into these 4 steps, we can cut down the algorithms that we need to learn from 4,000 to 16. That's definitely a manageable amount that anyone can learn, but if it's still too much for you, I found a way to memorize even less. If speed isn't super important to you, you can learn a method I found that's a little bit slower than normal, but to solve the entire last layer, you only need to memorize 4 algorithms. Yeah, you heard me right. You can solve the entire last layer with 4 algorithms. 2 algorithms for OLL and 2 algorithms for PLL. They're named Beginner OLL and Beginner PLL, links in the description. Thank you guys so much for watching this video. I hope you learned something, and I'll see you next time.